Welcome to Forum at 360. I'm Jeremy Shea. Tonight, we have a panel of four former state legislators with decades of experience in state and local politics. They've all had leadership roles building state budgets and working on the permanent fund during booms and busts. Fran Ulmer was lieutenant governor during the Tony Knowles administration. She's a former state legislator who led the House Democrats, former Juneau mayor, and she worked for Governor Jay Hammond as the permanent fund was being established. More recently, she was chancellor of the University of Alaska Anchorage. Rick Halford is a former Republican legislator who served as Senate president. He was active in the House and the Senate from the 1970s through 2002. He also had oversight of the permanent fund's evolution. More recently, he served as a leader in Governor Walker's transition team. Gail Phillips is a Republican who served 10 years in the Alaska House of Representatives, 4 years as House Speaker. That includes 1998, the year when oil prices fell below $9 per barrel. She's owned small businesses and also served in local government with the Homer City Council and Kenai Peninsula Borough. And Mike Navarre is former Democratic lawmaker who represented the Kenai Peninsula in the 1980s and the 1990s. He chaired the House Finance Committee and has been mayor of the Kenai Peninsula Borough since 2011. What lessons and advice do they have for today's lawmakers and policymakers who are wrestling with a multi-billion dollar budget deficit? We've brought in Dermot Cole, columnist for the Alaska Dispatch News, and Matt Buxton, Capitol reporter for the Fairbanks Daily News Miner, to help us find true north in the budget dilemma. Matt, Dermot, why don't you go ahead?
Okay, well, I would like to start by asking all of you maybe the same question. You all have great experience in state and local government and have been around Alaska a long time. What's the most important thing the legislature has to do this year to begin grappling with the financial crisis? Mike?
They've got to make some progress. They've got to close part of the gap, and they've got to make some very difficult and tough decisions, none of which will be popular, but they've got to make progress.
In one word, they have to do something. They can't go leave the session without taking some action to change the way that they're looking at the budget and to filling that deficit. And I know that a lot of the legislators say the first thing that we've got to do is we've got to make cuts. They can't hide behind that this year. You can't make enough cuts to balance the budget, to get rid of the deficit. So they've got to do something with all the different parts.
Rick?
I think they got to build trust by a real open discussion of every possible alternative, including the ones they disagree with. I think if they do that and make some progress, I think they've accomplished something. I think you've got a gap that's taken a decade to get there. If they can get through it in 3 years, they've done a lot.
I think the legislature needs to overcome the temptation to put politics and their own reelection ahead of doing the right thing for the state, and instead come up with a bipartisan solution to the challenge we face that involves reducing spending, imposing taxes, using permanent fund earnings, and explaining to the people of the state that that's the only way that there will be a dividend, and that's the only way our economy will remain strong.
You've all had positions of power in the legislature, and probably today you're freer to speak about it than you were then. What are some of the things that might be hindering, what are some of the things that make it difficult to do what you've just said? It sounds pretty simple the way these last couple of minutes of description, but what makes it so difficult? Fran, you want to start?
Well, fear that whatever decision that is made, particularly an unpopular one, might mean that they don't get reelected or that they cannot adequately explain to the public that what they're doing is really in the best interests of the state of Alaska. And unfortunately, a number of the things that have already been done to cut the budget, people haven't felt it yet. The reduction in the capital budget, the reduction in other ways in which in about 6 to 9 months, maybe a year, people will begin to feel that tightening. But by the time the pain is really felt, it will actually be too late. The legislature needs to act before the people of the state beg for a solution.
Fran, you mentioned explaining to the public. We've heard that in the first few days of the session now. We've heard legislators talk about how the public doesn't know, they've already made cuts, how the media is not necessarily explaining the situation properly. How do you go about describing the situation to the public and making sure they know where we're at?
Well, a few simple numbers might help. We have a $5.2 billion budget, and we only have about $1.6 billion in income. So that means we have a gigantic hole that currently we are filling with savings. And if you realize we have two sources of savings, constitutional budget reserve, earnings reserve, each of those has about $7 billion in it. You've only got four more years of being able to fill the gap between roughly what we're spending today and what we're earning. So after 4 years, we have the potential to fall off the cliff, which would not be good for either the services that are provided to people or our economy. So I think part of the answer to your question is simpler numbers and explaining that if we don't fill the gap now, within 4 years, we will be out of money and facing a potential situation that we cannot get ourselves out of.
I'd like to know, do you, the rest of you sort of agree with that synopsis? Rick, do you?
I think the numbers are right. There's a lot of proposals, a lot of sources, and I think there's some things being left out of the equation.
Such as?
Well, I think, you know, some people think you shouldn't look at any taxes as the economy is under stress. But in fact, going after the permanent fund dividend, capping the dividend, takes the same amount out of the economy as an income tax, but it takes it all out of Alaskans, and it takes it in a way that's regressive, and probably by all studies that I've seen from ICER or anyone else, the least efficient. But that doesn't mean it's not on the table, but it does mean that consideration's got to be taken up. Okay, I think we're looking at, if you look at the same number, if, you know, take a half a billion dollars as an increment and say a half a billion dollar increment in permanent fund dividend income, a half a million billion dollar increment in income taxes, a half a billion dollar increment in payable tax credits to the oil companies. Yes, we have seen some tough times, but we're still producing almost $7 billion worth of oil. And that oil was worth a split of one-third, 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 and everybody agreed to it years ago. Maybe that needs to be looked at.
Okay, but it doesn't but at these prices, the oil company is not making money on the North Slope. They may be making money for marketing and refining, but their costs, you know, exceed the price of a barrel of oil.
Well, they may, and there may be one company that's going to go forward with a net loss this year. But because we don't have separate accounting, thanks to some foolish people, I was included in that group, that repealed that, we don't have the data. So we don't know how vertically integrated companies are allocating their profits or losses. But I think that belongs on the table.
Are you saying you would distribute the pain? Is that sort of what you were saying?
Well, I think that's true, but the problem is, you know, when you're adding things to a budget and you add a limb to a Christmas tree, people like it and you gain votes. When you're adding negatives together, you lose votes with everything you add for fairness. You have a single subject rule. You can't do it all in one bill. So there's a lot of difficulty in making that happen. I think it's got to be done one at a time, and then it becomes kind of a credibility test of what do you do first.
Gail, what do you think to do? What's your?
You asked what do the legislators fear, and what are their main concerns about taking action this year? I hope they have great fear of what will happen to the state of Alaska if they don't do something, if they don't take action. It is critical that they take it. But this idea that people in Alaska are aware that we have this budget crisis, that aware what's going on the plane today when we were coming down, there were several people I talked to coming down here to lobby the legislature for more money. This is a year we have a huge budget deficit, and these are knowledgeable people that have worked here in Juneau and been in Juneau for many years, and yet they're coming down to try to get more money. So there's a big disconnect.
Okay, how many people were you on the plane coming down here to lobby for Reduced funding.
I talked to three people that were coming down to lobby for.
For more money.
For more money.
Well, I was trying to be, I was being a little sarcastic, but
yeah.
Is anybody going to come down here and say, please,
no, but
give me less money?
At some point in time, whether it's a nonprofit organization or an agency or a department head, people have got to realize we're facing a crisis this year that has to be addressed.
Okay, Mike, why is it a crisis?
Well, we have a crisis because we don't have enough revenues to meet our budget needs. Simple as that. And there's lots of different options available for fixing it. What the legislature needs to avoid is getting mired down in rhetoric and politics around it, because each different option has its own politics associated with it, and it's going to take some consensus, and it's going to take coalitions on different issues between both parties in order to get there, or you won't get there. Neither party can do it alone. And they also, the legislature needs to recognize that they ran for those jobs. It's their responsibility. They should be and are going to be ahead of the public in terms of grasping the problem and the need to act now. They can't wait for the public to give them permission. It's better to act swiftly this year and ask for forgiveness rather than wait, because then it'll be a crisis.
Well, as a practical matter, when would permission ever be granted?
Yeah,
I can't imagine that's ever going to happen.
Yeah, none of the options are really very politically popular with the public. You know, it's, if you look at the areas of the budget, the three biggest areas: education, health and social services, and then bond debt reimbursement and retirement.
Retirement.
Those things are very. That's more than two thirds of the entire budget, almost three quarters of the entire budget. So those areas are. One area can't be cut. Health and social services and education are very popular and a high priority and should be. But everything does have to be on the table, and we have to make good progress in terms of closing that gap.
Alaska, you know, has been, I feel like this is kind of a retread oftentimes of like prior fiscal crises that we've had, and you see a lot of stuff that's similar sometimes, like, you know, I think I saw something where you could basically switch out the names of people and you'd have a similar situation now. What's different this time around, and what's the same, I guess? You know, especially, I'm looking to you, Gail, as you were here with...
Probably one of the most simple explanation is when the price of oil fell below $9 a barrel when I was Speaker. Our budget had been based on a number twice that much. So that was quite a drop in the price of oil. However, oil production through the pipeline was very high at that time. And so we had that good production to carry us through, getting through that was kind of a mini crisis compared to where we are today.
I think at that time oil production was 1.2 million barrels
right.
per day. Today is 500,000, yeah. Around 500,000. So the impact is magnified, mm-hmm. of this.
And we didn't have, at that time, we didn't have the huge debt retirement or retirement, debt or retirement.
Not as high. But part of the problem that we're having right now is that because of depressed oil prices, we've had a false economy for years. All of our state spending has largely been dependent on oil and gas revenues. And so we've built this false economy that every other entity doesn't necessarily pay its way, or pay its way and then enough to pay for the costs associated with the jobs that are created in that industry. So, and right now, it's not just state spending and closing the state fiscal gap. You got to keep an eye on the economy, because what we're seeing now with low oil prices is investment decisions that are being made by the company not to go forward with projects, mm-hmm. cutting positions in Alaska, and you have to look at the cumulative impact of that on the economy. And that's also why it's important to do something significant this year in closing that gap, because it sort of lays the framework or the groundwork for business confidence into the future and getting new investment in the upcoming years into Alaska.
I wonder if any of you have a comment about this. The Standard & Poor's, the bond rating agency, has, you know, lowered, for its purposes, lowered the state bond rating by one level, and has threatened that there will be more if the state does not adjust to this situation. what would be the real impact of a serious downgrade in the state credit rating? Is it the financial impact on bonds, or is it a confidence in the Alaska economy?
Yes.
Both. Yeah.
Both of those things. Mm-hmm. I think it sends a terrible signal, not just to businesses that are currently here now, but to businesses that might have thought of Alaska as a good opportunity zone. It's like, oh, caution, can't go there. And it affects the bond rating for municipalities and for everybody else. So, I mean, there are lots of ways in which that could hurt us in a very dramatic way.
When we talk about the economy here, you know, we've heard talks about how income taxes will stifle economic growth. We hear about the permanent fund, we hear about sales tax. I mean, what, you know, for a healthy economy, you know, what's the preferred, is there a preferred package of new revenues that doesn't hurt it?
All of them have some effect on the economy, because all of them either take spending out of the economy, or in fact all of them take spending out of the economy, and when you do that, you're going to have economic impacts. Alaska is going to have some economic impacts. What we have to do is look out where we want to be 5 years from now and 10 years from now, and make the decisions now that best enable us to get there. And if as Fran pointed out, if we see the bond ratings get cut again, it has a lot of long-term impacts, because the infrastructure needs in the state aren't going to go away. The population is not all of a sudden going to go be cut in half. So we're going to have a lot of needs, and in order to finance those needs, we'll be paying more money to finance that debt. And so that's a scary economic impact.
I would hope that the legislature this year would give serious consideration to every part that needs to be done, whether it's a sales tax or income tax. And I would prefer to see a income tax rather than a sales tax.
Why?
Based on my experience with local government, just the Kenai Peninsula alone, in Homer we have a sales tax. On top of the Homer sales tax, we have a borough tax. So if you added a state tax on to that already, then all of a sudden you've got 10, 12, 13 cents tax on every dollar spent. So that would hurt, I believe a sales tax hurts local government. I think income tax, there's a lot of benefits to an income tax. A lot of people in Alaska still think that it's the North Slope workers are only people from out of state, so it would tax them for one thing. But income tax, if it was based a percentage of your federal income tax, I think it's the fairest way to tax people in Alaska. And nobody, we've gotten in this mindset that we could just live here for free. That should never have happened. We all owe for paying for roads and streets and airports and schools. Why wouldn't we want to pay our share of those? And so I think an income tax addresses that.
Now, Rick, were you in the legislature in 1980? I can't remember if that.
Yes, I was.
Okay, when the vote was taken to repeal the state income tax. Now, I believe Clem Tillion was the only one who voted against the repeal.
Yeah, I voted for the repeal. I wish I hadn't. But there was an initiative on the ballot that was going to take it away anyway. Hammond took the blame like he should have vetoed it. It didn't matter whether he vetoed it or not. It was going away.
Well, the veto would have been overridden, probably.
Well,
or if not, it would have passed on the ballot.
Yeah, it was already on the ballot, so it was really going away.
But what is it? Isn't a key decision how much we want to take out of the permanent fund, and why is that a difficult decision for the legislature?
Well, first of all, you're talking about the permanent fund, and the dividend is a short-term source. But if you look at the dividend compared to an income tax is going to get paid by a lot of non-residents. Taking out of the dividend is going to be only residents. It's going to be loaded to the bottom end of the scale, to kids. It's the most regressive way you can take money out of the economy, by taking it out of the dividend
side.
But
this is not an either-or proposition.
I can understand that it may not be, but again, your credibility goes a lot with what you do first. And I think if you go to a progressive income tax, I think you've got a lot more credibility and you have less impact. Every study you see says the biggest bang for the buck in the economy, in all of the economy, is to feed from the bottom instead of feed from the top.
Well, the trickle down has introduced a package, right, to try to do all these things at once. Mm-hmm. You know, and the odds makers probably don't give him a, you know.
But the rest of your question is about the permanent fund itself. And
right. Well, and I was separating the dividend from the permanent fund.
The permanent fund itself, if you look at the sovereign wealth funds around the world, the Saudi sovereign wealth fund is losing billions of dollars. It is eating its principal today. And the Norwegian sovereign wealth fund, anything below $48 oil, it is eating its principal. We don't want to be there. Whatever we do with regard to the permanent fund, maintain the principal. So,
no, but the flip side of that is that whether it's sovereign wealth fund or an endowment fund, is that you may, during periods of poor investment or downturns, you may eat into some of the fund capital, but you also replenish it during good times. And that's something that you have to keep in mind. It's designed to sort of flatten out the ups and downs over time. And I think that's something that's a positive for Alaska.
I think it really is important to say something that probably will surprise both of you and maybe the audience as well. All four of us think a personal income tax is the right thing to do for the reasons that have been articulated, but also because it's the easiest to administer. You just take a percentage of whatever it is that you've paid the feds. If you create a statewide sales tax, you got to put in place a huge bureaucracy and it becomes confusing, and it's a tax, an additional tax in terms of work for small business. So we're all aligned on that. And I think we're all aligned also on the fact that some permanent fund earnings need to fill the gap. There may be differences about how you structure it, whether it's a percent of market value or a sovereign wealth, or you take the earnings and you take a portion of it for dividend and a portion of it for government. But I think we all agree those things aren't either or. They really have to both be done. It's just a question of when. And I think all four of us also agree that actually sooner rather than later is the way to do the right thing for the state.
The governor's proposed income tax would bring in about $200 million. And I believe it's 6% of the federal, Matt, you can correct me if I'm wrong, 6% of your federal tax.
That's about a third of what our income tax was before, when it was based on a much more progressive federal tax schedule.
Well, would you advocate a higher income? I'm going to ask you if you will advocate a higher income tax. But having said that, that would bring in $200 million, which is far less than a $4 billion fiscal gap, and $200 million, you're not adding up to real money yet, really, right?
I think the argument at $200 million is probably not worth the effort. I think you've got to look at bigger increments.
So a higher tax than
higher tax.
Well, and I think that's accurate, because I think the public is smart enough to figure that out, that it's the camel's nose argument that if once you get an income tax in place, you'll see higher levels. So I think that starting with a higher income tax level, as difficult as that is a better approach to it, and will, I think, build trust in the long term. You know, these arguments aren't going to go away. We're going to have debates about what level of income tax and what level of oil taxes and whether you use permanent fund earnings, etc., what level of spending. It's going to go on forever. We don't need to have a perfect plan. We just need to have a plan that makes good progress. I think that means income tax or a broad-based tax. You know, I support it over sales tax, because sales tax, you got to hire a lot more people on sales tax. You got to hire auditors. You got to hire enforcement. You got to do it all over the state that's not currently collecting sales tax. So income tax is much, much simpler to do. And permanent fund earnings. There has to be some component of the fix this year that includes permanent fund earnings.
Are people going to be attacked this year if they run for office for taking? For dipping into the permanent fund,
they get attacked every year, no matter what happens.
Right, it depends what else they do in large.
But they cannot go out of here at the end of the year and say we are only going to take the first step in making cuts. That's not acceptable. I don't believe that's not acceptable, because that doesn't get us anywhere against drawing down our savings accounts.
But you know, if something passes, it's going to have to pass by consensus. It's going to have to be bipartisan, which means a majority of the legislature is going to support it. If you have a majority of the legislature supporting something that makes good progress, I think you'll also get a majority of the of former legislators. I think you'll get a majority of the business community. I think you'll get a majority of local governments. And I think you'll end up with a majority of the public.
I mean, but up there right now, you know, the sales tax seems to be the emerging preferred option right now. And why Why would that be popular, especially in an election year? And you guys have already begun to outline why it's a bad idea.
I was surprised to see that there was an emphasis placed on a sales tax, because most communities in Alaska have their own sales taxes.
Yeah, but there's one that begins
with one big one that doesn't, right? And so that the
and they have a lot of legislators.
Yeah,
and I think that's who's talking about this. Our Anchorage legislators who like the idea of a sales tax, maybe. Well, but how about this? The legislative rule that maybe not a rule, but do you need a majority of the majority in order for this to go forward?
That's a bad rule, and it's not really a rule. It's sort of de facto what sometimes they operate under. But having a majority of the majority is not the way to go with a crisis of this significance.
No. Every legislator, all 60 legislators, have to buy into the solution on this. And every one of them has to put their effort forward to get us to a solution.
But it's not going to be unanimous, right? It's never.
Probably won't be unanimous, but they all have to participate in trying to reach a solution.
The leadership. You hear the leadership, like in both bodies, say that we need to do something. But I think it's going to be down to the other members who aren't on these committees. What kind of message do you have for them to make them see the light, I guess, and get them involved in this? I mean, I think those are the people. In the middle, who?
Well, as is usually the case, elected officials tend to listen more attentively to their own constituents, right? So I think a piece of the solution here is that people in the districts, in each individual community, needs to speak to their legislator about how doing nothing is really going to hurt their community, their economy, the services that they rely on. So I do think this is a great example of one of those things that it's not just legislators talking to each other. I think it's people in Alaska talking to their legislators and explaining why, if they do the right thing, that they'll get protected. They will get the kind of support that maybe they're fearful they will lose.
And we've already seen business groups form alliances. And those alliances are made up of business and labor unions and educators and people from all over the state coming together with support to cover the legislature, saying you need to do this, you can't walk away without doing something.
Is this one of the reasons the permanent fund was established, in your view? I mean, Fran, you were in the Hammond administration when the vote took place in 76.
Thank goodness we adopted the constitutional amendment that created this permanent fund. You know, I just have to say, we've been talking sort of about the negative side, but let's talk about the positive side. There aren't a lot of states that are as positioned as we are to actually be able to solve our problems. And so thank goodness the people of the state in 1976 said yes. And yes, the discussion in 75, as this bill, well, first the resolution passed the House and Senate and then went to the people, was, you know, we do need to save something for the future. Because when the pipeline was built and when the oil started flowing in 1977, the prediction was that Prudhoe Bay would last maybe 20 or 25 years, and then it would be over. So what's happened subsequently in terms of the enhanced drilling technology and the other fields, you know, all of that is gravy on top of the original Prudhoe Bay predictions. But people, when they voted, knew that someday it was going to end and someday we would need a stream of revenue to be able to provide for essential public services. And so, yes, that was unquestionably an important part. And I will just say, because I worked for Jay Hammond at the time as his legislative assistant, you know, we went out to talk to the public to try to encourage people to vote for the amendment, understanding that. Now, clearly, the dividend came later. It was always in Jay's mind, but in terms of the public discussion, the dividend being adopted a few years later helped give political support to keep the permanent fund alive. And I mean, the good news is, as a state, from that standpoint, we've been very responsible in putting additional money into the permanent fund, and we are the envy of the nation that we have it. But that rainy day has arrived, and we're going to have to use some of those earnings for the original purpose that the permanent fund was adopted.
You know, as someone who has criticized the legislature in the past, I would say over the years, the Alaska legislature, because of its original actions in part, setting the structure put with the permanent fund and deposits over the years are a key reason why it exists today. And people say, you know, that who don't, you know, who distrust the legislature on everything should give the legislature credit for that. It's been,
and
that,
some
that's
of those
been a large legislative
Some of those deposits were pretty tough to make because the needs were so great in our state to take that money and do provide services that people want. And it was those were some tough battles to make those deposits, but it was the right thing to do at the time.
You know, speaking of tough battles, in 1999, and Rick, I remember you were one of the leaders against the advisory vote. How if, and that vote was about whether or not to use a portion of permanent fund earnings to help run government. Oil prices were way down. There was a fiscal crisis at the time. How is today different from that situation?
Well, today is different, but the initial conclusion is still the same. The permanent fund is still the last place we should go after we have started to pay our own way, started to get a fair return on our resources. Then maybe, and just as Jay Hammond did, you know, the Senate in that same time frame, somewhere along there, passed a 40-30-30 proposal, which allowed some permanent fund income after inflation proofing and dividends to go into government. And we all supported it as an alternative, but it did have some protection. It said, yes, the permanent fund dividend is going to change, but it's going to be guaranteed not to change further. And I think it really is. I mean, the currency of change is trust. And that's what we got to build if you're going to have people go along with something. I think when you have, you know, one of the things difficult about the whole process is everybody gets sucked into appropriations that you don't particularly like. The year that we go into the permanent fund or change the dividend or expect their approval of an income tax is not the year to have legislative office buildings. It's the year to have the cleanest budget they can come up with, because people will think their dividend went into whatever the worst expenditure they can think of.
Although to be honest about this, I mean, the legislative office building in Anchorage is very, very small item compared to what we're facing.
Right. It's symbolic. That's
the key
problem.
Thing to keep in mind. Yeah, there's going to be a lot of things. No matter what happens this year in the legislature, people who want to be detractors are going to pick things out of the budget and say we shouldn't have been spending money on that. That happens in every election cycle and every single year. But you have to keep in mind that private companies, when their earnings are down, they cut their dividends. And Alaska needs to consider earnings of the permanent fund and perhaps cutting the dividends. It doesn't mean that the dividends can't go up again in the future. And things can change if suddenly oil price spikes again for a long period of time or something else on the horizon comes in, generates a bunch of revenue for the state. But absent that, we need to look at permanent fund earnings. We need to look at reducing the dividend. And we, in order to preserve earnings for our budget, and we need to look at broad-based taxes, and I support an income tax if we're going to broad-based taxes.
And how many programs do you want to eliminate? I mean, when budget cuts are discussed, people don't specify what they want to cut.
How do you go about?
The mantra from the public is just cut the budget, but don't cut these programs or this that I support. That help me. Don't cut those, you cut the other person's. So just the whole issue of just cutting the budget is, you know, you could make a budget streamlined and you could make a budget efficient, but you're not going, there's very few programs in Alaska that I think are gonna be successfully done away with.
In the 1990s, when the legislature tried to cut, if I remember, $250 million over a period of 4 years, I believe, there were no real programs eliminated. In fact, the last program I remember being eliminated was the longevity bonus.
Yes.
And former Governor Murkowski paid dearly for that because it didn't really help him among the recipients of the longevity bonus. So, but still, legislators are talking about cutting the budget. So how do we get past this?
And they're talking about cutting the budget without specifics. They're talking about, you know, in the jargon term, unallocated reductions.
If you're going to cut the budget in a significant way, there's only two areas that eat up most of the budget, maybe three if you can include the University of Alaska, but it's education, K-12 education, a formula program, it's health and social services, mostly the Medicaid program, And that's it. That's the biggest areas of spending in the budget. So everything else, by comparison, is really minimal. Doesn't mean that you shouldn't cut it, but there's already a process in place for that. The legislature goes through, the finance committees put the budgets together. That process is already going to take place, and we will see some cuts in those areas. But it's not going to close the gap, and it's not going to fix it for the future.
There might be somebody watching this who say, okay, cut K-12 education. Now, what's the political ramifications
of
doing that?
In the 90s, we actually cut the education budget. And, you know, it hurt the schools for a little while, but they, as money came back into the system, they regrouped and they upped their employment and they paid teachers a lot more money than they had before. And so, you know, it didn't destroy Alaska's education system when we cut the budget in the 90s. Education budget.
Everything's going to have impacts.
Yeah.
One of the terms we've heard is right-sizing government. Is the government, what is the right size of the government? How do you get there?
It depends on what age group of person you talk to and where that person lives.
one of the problems for me is, you know, I left, a dozen years ago, and the budget was about half of what it is today. But a huge piece of that is health care. Just incredibly high. I mean, we're twice what the next highest country is, and we're way out of sight to all the rest of our nation. We have got some real problems in those kind of areas. I wish we could unravel the last dozen years, because if you go back that far, it was about the same price of oil when I left as it is now. And production was, you know, a couple hundred million barrels higher, so it was still better. But I think they've got to keep pushing on. Part of the budget reduction is the credibility that they're going the right direction, because numerically we still look way out of line to the rest of the country.
You know, you mentioned unallocated cuts as opposed to specific program cuts that's being discussed. And I will just say, as somebody who has spent time both in the executive branch and in the legislative branch, I would really employ legislators not to simply hand the governor a cut and say, do it. Because honestly, one of the constitutional responsibilities of the legislature is to appropriate and to set policy. And you do that through the budget. So I would just urge legislators to resist the temptation to pass the buck to the governor by just doing unallocated and say, just take it and run with it. Because what happens then, of course, politically, he'll get the blame, right, for the cuts. My point is just from the standpoint of how our constitutional framers set up responsibilities among the three branches, it really is up to the legislature. And when they say, we're just going to cut the budget and, you know, we'll make it streamlined and we'll right-size government, it's really their responsibility. So if they think there are programs that we don't need as a state, or that don't contribute to communities, or that aren't essential in building our future, regardless of what that's in, I really say that is the legislature's job. And if they go home with just a big unallocated cut and say to the governor, do it, I would urge the governor to veto that budget and say, come back and do your job.
Well, do you agree with that analysis, that an unallocated budget cut is passing the buck?
Absolutely, yeah.
The other thing that has happened in the past is fund source switches. A lot of the early cuts, and we all participated in the structure that was there, but a lot of the early general fund cuts through the 90s were fund source switches. Most of those have been kind of worn out because they're all used up, so you don't have a big dividend coming.
For instance, like tuition increase? Become an unrestricted general, restricted, I guess.
Some of that, there's all kinds of
AHFC money.
AHFC money
all kinds of off-budget items that weren't general fund.
But they were proposed as cuts to the general fund, and that was accurate but not really honest.
No,
it was later than that.
Okay.
And I think we all participated in it. And actually it got rid of a lot of those areas that were off budget money, because we used them to replace general fund, and it got things back there. But it's, you know, be honest about it. Don't say you're cutting something you're not cutting. Don't count the unfilled positions as part of all the people you're supposed to
that
be
is
not
one,
having.
Yeah.
I mean, those kinds of things destroy the credibility of the process, mm-hmm. and that's what's got to go up to get buy-in.
Do you think, what would you advise legislators, you know, to do? Exactly. Are they sending the right message to the public?
The message they're sending to the public, the message I have heard, as somebody that has been there and so knows what this message is that's coming from them, is they will take action, they will possibly take action after they have made budget cuts. That's not a complete message. That's not a good message. They've got to make some cuts, because in order to get the whole package passed, they have to get votes from all of their people. So there will be some cuts that will need to be done. But they have got to address the other key parts too. And probably the easiest one for them to do this year is take the earnings, use the permanent fund earnings reserve, and use the funds from there. But I'd like to see, personally, I'd like to see a cap on the dividend also. I'd like that discussion to
And
to
Rick,
come
you agree with that, don't you?
I do not agree with that,
well,
of course.
What do you,
I think the first step, the governor introduced a bill on oil tax credits. I think it should pass. It gets us back $500 million that we're spending. And our whole income on oil, where we have basically got a tax system that produces a negative number, and then the ownership side, the royalty side, is getting it up to a positive number, something under $1 billion out of a $7 billion product. I think that's the first step.
Well, no, but wait, but we're in that position, let's admit this, because of a net profits tax as opposed to a gross profits tax. Do you think we should go back to a gross profits tax?
Well, I don't know that you can do everything all at once. I think you're going to have to start with a first year of a program, and if you can cover a third of the difference the first year, a third the second year, and a third the third year, you've got something that actually worked, and you did it with reserves left over at the end.
You mean, so the first year it'd be a $2.5 billion from savings?
No, the first year, yes, yeah. Exactly. The first year, you start with the resource, you go to a broad-based income tax, you make cuts in the very beginning of the process, and you try to get to a third of the gap.
Oh, no, but isn't the likelihood that in 3 years the permanent fund earnings reserve will be zero based on that kind of approach, meaning no dividend?
Well, I don't. Number one, the earnings reserve doesn't mean no dividend if the income of the year covers the dividend. The earnings reserve is for after the fact inflation proofing and dividends because of the way it's calculated. But the bottom line is if you do your first year completely, and your second year, and your third year, you have the permanent fund system the way it is today. I think in that process, you get to a point where you go back to something like 40-30-30.
Mike, did you want to say something about that? I saw you shaking your head.
You know, I was just shaking my head because you got to be really, really cautious. You can change things in the future if things turn out better than you think, but this has to be addressed, I think, pretty firmly the first year. I think a third is too small of a target to shoot for in terms of filling the budget gap. It's going to be difficult. There's no question that the legislators are in a very, very difficult situation politically and certainly economically. But I don't think a third is enough progress. And I also think that if you spend down the earnings reserve and you get to the point where you have no reserve, the dividend does go away. Even though it technically could keep going under the statutes, it wouldn't keep going because you'd be in you would have no revenues to meet the budget, ongoing budget. So I think decisive action. I think the sooner you deal with things, it's like they say, do a quick cut rather than a bunch of little small cuts, and you'll be better off in the long run. Every single decision that the legislature makes, whether the income tax is at $200 million or $500 million, it's going to be as difficult no matter the number. So take the bigger bite now with the idea that you can dial back on it if things are better than expected in the future.
Gail?
In, I think it was 96 or 97, the leadership the administration leadership and the House and Senate leadership came to an agreement that we would go and try to get our caucuses, our bodies, to approve a cap on the dividend at that time of $1,000. We had not gone over, that year, we had not gone over $1,000 on a dividend yet. So it was the right time to have placed a cap on the dividends, because we could see these kind of budget deficits coming. And we all agreed. We went back to our caucuses all gung-ho to get this done. Couldn't get our caucuses to go along with it on both sides.
And you probably had people like Mr. Halford arguing,
disagreeing.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah. I mean, so if we had done that, then I think that would have helped us greatly today.
Well, but
if we could have done that then.
But again, let's look back a little bit. The crisis passed, right?
Right.
I mean, the crisis of the late 90s did pass when oil prices shot up dramatically.
Yeah.
After in the final year of Governor Frank Murkowski's term. I mean, do you think
I think
is one third enough? I mean, Fran, do you think is that? I mean, to deal with one third of the issue this year.
There are a number of moving parts, so let's make an assumption. Let's make an assumption that we keep the budget roughly the same level. Maybe we reduce it a couple hundred million. The price of oil does not go up very much, and this legislature doesn't have the courage to adopt taxes. Under that scenario, we have exactly 4 years of reserves, 2 under the Constitutional Budget Reserve, 2 under the Earnings Reserve, and then we have no money. Then we are in a situation of actual bankruptcy, or a constitutional amendment to undo the permanent fund itself, because we will not have the money. That is the worst case but possible alternative future if we don't take very dramatic action this year and next year and the next year. One third, no, I mean, you can't get there from here because of the size of the gap. So we have to be more aggressive this year. There's no doubt about it. And I would just say, back to the dividend for a second, I've been a supporter of the dividend from the beginning. I did a lot of work with Jay on how the Alaska Inc., the first version, went. I understand why it's important to individuals, to the economy, and why it's actually been really good from the standpoint of public policy. But I am fearful that not only the dividend goes away in 4 years, but potentially the permanent fund itself. And that is what I think we have to concentrate on. Not how difficult it is going to be this year, but what we do to make sure that for the long term, we have a viable state. It's that serious.
Can the legislature do this in 1 year?
They can take dramatic steps towards it, yes. You know, they're going to make the cuts. They can put a bill in place to put in some kind of a taxation. They can do that. They can take a percentage of the earnings and fund the budget. They can do these things. Of course they can.
And get reelected?
Possibly not.
You know, a better goal than getting reelected ought to be give the next legislature the tools that they need to deal with what's going to be an ongoing problem.
Maybe the next generation as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. This problem's not going away anytime soon.
So this is a good opportunity, I think, for us to start talking a little bit more about actually the legislature and the challenges specifically that, you know, can they do this? And so first, I think we need to take a little short moment. We've got a video produced by Alaska Public Media that outlines the budget problem that they're facing. So let's watch that, and then we'll dive into this discussion of whether or not they can tackle this problem. Is that good, Jeremy?
Say the state budget is your lunch. There's a lot there. About $2.5 billion comes from the federal government. That money's earmarked for specific things, so let's set it aside. What's left is the general fund. That's what the governor and lawmakers have to come up with each year. Over the last decade, most of that has come from oil revenue. As recently as a couple years ago, that worked pretty well. Oil prices were really high. But since then, prices have plummeted, and oil production is down too. Now, lawmakers have to figure out how to make the state's lunch with a lot less in the fridge. Option one, cut spending. There are a few things that make up the bulk of the budget. The biggest chunk is education. Next is health and social services. More than half of this is Medicaid. Number three, refundable oil tax credits. These go mostly to smaller companies, many of them in Cook Inlet. Then there's the University of Alaska and the Department of Corrections. And the Department of Transportation. People talk about cutting all kinds of things, like the legislature's expensive office space in Anchorage, or per diem for lawmakers and staff. What if we just cut the whole legislature? And while we're at it, the governor's office. That still leaves $1 billion in the budget. Option two, raise revenue. That means taxes. Right now, the state expects to take in just over $1 billion in oil revenue and $500 million in all other taxes. What if we double the minimum tax on oil companies? Governor Bill Walker has proposed the first income tax since 1980. Some lawmakers have said they'd like a sales tax better. Call it a 3% sales tax. The governor has also proposed raising taxes on fishing, mining, tourism, and motor fuel. Also alcohol and tobacco. And there's always that marijuana tax. And all of that only gets us halfway there. Option three, raid the cookie jar. The state has two main savings accounts. There's the Constitutional Budget Reserve. That's the state's rainy day fund. Then there's the permanent fund. You can't touch the principal, but you can use the earnings. Here's the catch. A big chunk of those earnings go to the permanent fund dividend. So if you use the earnings, you reduce the dividend. In the end, the state will have to decide on some combination of cuts, taxes, and savings. Otherwise, the deficit is going to eat our lunch.
Most people should be able to understand that.
So the legislature, you know, one of the issues we talked about as far as implementing revenues and changes to the permanent fund is a matter of credibility. What's your guys' assessment of this current legislature's credibility, and how can they either improve it or get it to a place where the public will come along with them on these changes? Because, you know, we're asking the people to pay for something that they haven't paid for in, 30, 40 years, so.
You know, there's a big difference between the legislature as a whole and individual legislators and their popularity within their own districts. It's one of the things, when I was in the legislature, one of my brothers would always get in discussions with me and say, those people down in Juneau don't like, are only there to feather their own nest or line their own pockets. They don't care about us normal people. And I said, well, you know, I'm your representative. I don't mean you. I mean all those other legislators. And that's part of, legislators are very popular generally. They've been elected by a majority in their districts, but as a whole, there's so much negative campaigning these days that it sort of puts a negative connotation on the legislature as a whole. And that's really kind of a sad commentary of how politics has evolved both in the country and in this state, and something that, you know, you have to have confidence in the legislature. The legislature were elected by a majority of the folks in the state and their districts, and they have the ability to solve the problem if they lead.
And do you see them leading right now?
You know, I think that I guess I've seen a little bit change in the tone over the course of the last year. I think that clearly the legislature recognizes the magnitude of the problem, and I think they're working to address it. It's going to take some time, but they'll get through it.
Is that something you guys all agree with?
I think so. And you know, the legislature, they have so much more information coming to them than the general public has. Then, as knowledgeable as the four of us are about the legislative process, we don't have access, or we don't have anywhere near the information that the legislature has to make the decisions that they have to make. So I think that's always, the public always looks at the legislature as they don't know what they're talking about, but they do, but they have to analyze everything that comes before them.
I guess the question is, who do you trust, right? I mean, who do people trust? They trust their friends and neighbors. They trust people they work with. They maybe trust their spouse, maybe not. You know, I mean, who do you go to for advice about your life, about your business dealings, about the state budget? You know, this is a hard question that you're asking. But I think part of the problem is that, frankly, all of us as elected leaders, at one time or another, we don't like to tell bad news. We like to tell good news. We like to make people happy, not sad. So I think there's been a long period of time of elected people not really being honest about those bologna slices and bread slices and how much we really don't have by way of opportunities to just simply easily cut the budget and nobody feel it. So I think honesty is a piece of it. I think that's what Rick is saying. I mean, you've got to be more transparent. So I think that's part of what needs to be done. And I think the fact that there are a lot of community business leaders, former elected officials, being willing to step up and validate that the time is now for action and that it's not stealing your dividend. No, quite the contrary. It's actually being able to assure that your kids still have a dividend by doing something now instead of ignoring the problem. So we all need to be part of the solution.
You were all here in the 1980s when the economy collapsed after the construction boom in the early 1980s. And there were foreclosures throughout the state, and it was a really difficult time for tens of thousands of people. Do you think we're facing a potentially similar situation?
If the legislature does not take action to close the gap, if they don't take some kind of action, I think we could face that's a similar type of crisis.
I think we have some of the same dynamics as we did then. I think that we've maybe learned from some of those mistakes. You can't take all the spending out of the economy at once. I think that we're going to have infrastructure needs. We ought to look at bonding for capital. That really just borrows the money now and pays it back later. It's one way to get some injection into the economy. There's no question that Alaska's economy is contracting and is going to contract a little bit. Whether or not we turn it into a full-blown economic crisis depends on the action that the legislature takes this year.
Rick, what do you think?
Every economist, liberal or conservative, says that the best way to feed the economy is from the bottom, not the top. The permanent fund dividend does that. That's why it's the last place to go. But I think we're not looking at the kind of recession we had in the 80s because that economy was built on house builders building houses for house builders to live in when they built more houses for house builders to live in and so forth. It was a false economy in construction primarily. We are much more broadly based than that. We're going to see some contraction because our gross state product is worth half of what it was before or less. And the private sector decisions in the industry are going to take a lot of employees out. I don't think we should accentuate that any more than we absolutely have to in the public sector. But using the dividend as a source is the wrong thing to do for the overall economy. And all the way back to Milton Friedman's recommendations when the dividend was formed, people like Arlen Tussing, lots and lots of people looked at it, understood it, and all the studies have said it has the most positive impact of anything we do. So it shouldn't be the first thing on the table. But I think we're in for a recession or maybe a leveling out. But I don't think we're in for the crash of the mid-80s at all.
Well, one of the huge differences between then and now is that oil production then was climbing to the peak of of more than 2 million barrels per day. Mm-hmm. A price or a level of production at which a relatively small move in price could trigger a large increase in revenue. Today we have one quarter of that, and it's true that was a construction boom, but there are warning signs now that an economic cutback is going to occur.
There's a difference. There's a difference between then and now. One of the big differences, as you pointed out, was oil production was much higher, about four times what it is now. The other thing was in the early 80s, we had state revenues leap dramatically and a lot of spending went out in capital spending at the same time as the oil companies were investing a great deal of money in the early 80s in developing the North Slope and getting it up to full production. When they got it up to full production, they pulled that money out of the economy at the same time as the price dropped, and then the state pulled money out of the economy, and the combination of those two put us into a real tailspin. It was not really a false economy, but a little bit of a false economy then, because it was premised on continued growth and investment, and that wasn't sustainable because the companies weren't going to keep spending on the North Slope and the state couldn't keep spending in capital. So it's different now. We have a more diverse and a stronger economy, but if we don't make the right choices, we'll exacerbate the situation.
And you see that the legislature is looking seriously at making drastic cuts to the capital budget. Well, the capital budget keeps construction going on in the state and keeps people employed. So they made those cuts last year. There's probably enough money and projects in the pipeline right now to keep going for another year or so. But look at what they proposed for the capital budget this year. It's just minuscule in comparison to other recent capital budgets. So that's going to be another factor that's going to affect the general economy of the state.
So I agree with my colleagues that in some ways we are better off and in some ways we're worse. So the better off, as is indicated, you know, we are a more diversified economy. That's good. The Alaska Native corporations have really stood up in some dramatic ways, and that's a whole nother economic engine that is very powerful in our state today that wasn't anywhere near as forceful as it was then. So all of that's good, but as you point out, production is on the decline, and there is almost no scenario that shows that in any direction other than down. So the opportunity for growth in the future very much relies on a strong, diversified economy, which can be weakened dramatically if there's loss of confidence, and that loss of confidence goes back to the legislature taking action now, not later.
We've used the term deficit now for, ever since the oil price collapsed. And we also use it in the 1990s when oil revenue collapsed and permanent fund earnings exceeded oil income. But it's really not a deficit is probably the wrong word because we have, we're not running a surplus, but we are, permanent fund earnings are state revenues. And our terminology has sort of limited us, I think. Don't you think the earnings of the permanent fund are state revenue every bit as much as oil production taxes?
I do not. Absolutely. I believe the permanent fund is a follow-on for the constitutional provision that says the resources should be developed to the maximum benefit of the people. I think if you look at Elmer Rasmussen's statements and everybody else's statements as the permanent fund was built, they very specifically tied it to ownership. That's why it's equal. If you mix tax revenue and ownership revenue, ownership is what belongs to all generations of Alaskans. And whatever we do with a permanent fund or its dividends, it should be permanent. That's where it starts. That includes inflation proofing, and that includes some level of protection. If the protection requires splitting it three ways instead of two ways, so you have a dividend and you have insider political protection, that's one thing. But the permanent fund should be permanent from start to finish. There's going to be a time when there is zero oil production, not the $7 billion worth of oil we have today. And they're still going to have to educate people in groups of 20 or 30 or 40 on the banks of the Kobuk or wherever else. And they're not going to have any oil. So I think they're the same thing.
Do you have a different view?
Well, you know, I guess our opinions matter, but and to some people certainly, but the reality is that the constitutional amendment that was passed by Alaskans says those are general fund revenues. They go into the general fund. The legislature's done a very responsible job, really, setting up inflation proofing because that protects the value of the fund over time, and that's something that's a responsible action, mm-hmm. but it's not a mandated action. The earnings of the permanent fund are general fund revenues according to the Constitution. That's not how they've been used. They've been appropriated, I guess they have, because they've been appropriated for dividends and inflation proofing.
Gail,
I agree with Mike.
Just from the permanent fund annual report, permanent fund earnings are rightfully owned by the people of Alaska. They are not gifts bestowed by a generous government. They are constitutional rights. That's in the permanent fund annual report.
Although the Constitution says the earnings of the permanent fund are available for appropriation.
What else does it say at the end of the sentence?
I don't remember.
Unless otherwise provided by law.
Okay, but
when Hammond was governor, the permanent fund dividends were a dedication and didn't go through the general fund. after he left, it was changed to make them subject to appropriation so they could be vetoed by a following governor who wished that he could veto it.
Well, actually, no governor has a right to unilaterally change the Constitution. So by statute, it may have said that that's how the dividends were, but that's not what the Constitution allows. Any new legislature gets to make a determination on an annual basis, not the permanent fund board. The legislature has the power of appropriation.
The difference is no other provision of the Constitution says unless otherwise provided by law. The court will say that there's got to be some reason for it being there. The permanent fund income is legal to dedicate. And if it's dedicated, then in order to change it, it's not a matter of the legislative branch not appropriating. It's a matter of changing a law subject to an executive veto.
Right.
There's a substantial separation of powers
difference. There's a clear from the Constitution that the legislature has the power to appropriate all the earnings of the permanent fund. And it's clearly worded that way. The dividend was created by the legislature. By the Constitution.
It's all really the same, because the legislature writes the laws, and the legislature constitutionally has the power of appropriation, not just for the permanent fund. They have the power for all appropriation.
Okay, I didn't mean to send us off on that tangent, but
there's a difference in that particular amendment.
I'd like to go back to the baloney for a moment. I thought the slice was, of baloney was really kind of an interesting way of thinking about it. So if you think about the bread and the baloney, et cetera, just to kind of simplify what a piece of baloney is worth, actually the largest piece of baloney in terms of dollars going out of the state treasury is the total amount spent on the permanent fund dividend. $1.4 billion slice of baloney. That's larger than the $1.3 billion baloney slice for education. So the largest single expenditure in the state of Alaska is for permanent fund dividends. That, by the way, is about the same as what our total revenue is this year. We have $1 billion from the oil industry and $500 million from every other source. So $1.5 billion baloney slice from all taxes, $1.4 billion baloney slice goes out in permanent fund dividends, and $1.3 baloney slice goes out in education. I only say that because I think for the general public, sometimes it's really hard to get your head around how much are we spending on any one of these things? And the baloney slice actually helps. And those three are just about the same size. So if you really think about not only what are you going to cut, but what do you have to raise in new taxes to have three more baloney slices, you can see the size of the problem.
Well, I'm surprised you're not referring to that as lunch meat. but maybe it is baloney.
Well, I don't know.
Do you agree that the legislature can, I mean, they have less than 90 days left, right? So what can they?
They can do it.
They're not showing an inclination right now to deal with everything the governor has proposed.
They've only been in session for a week. So,
Well, I think there's been, well, we're not going to do that. That's sort of their, I think they're saying we're not going to do all that.
I think that I'm sensing that is, there's some softening there. They can do it if they set their minds to do it and do it. And if they say, that's going to be the main thing we do this session, we are going to address this problem. This is the most important thing facing Alaska today. We have to take care of that. Everything else can wait. They've got to take care of this.
They can start by taking the governor's tax and tax credit bills seriously. The bills are in.
One of the underlying kind of thoughts I guess I see up at the Capitol is I don't use government. I think that's sort of a fundamental issue I think we're having right now is we haven't paid for this in a long time. Why should we pay for it? Why should we have a government? There's sort of a feeling that from one legislator that the only service that she uses is the transfer sites, and why should we pay for schools? Why should we pay for any of this?
Roads, schools, airports, ports, ferry systems.
Troopers.
Everything in our state that is funded by the state, that is not funded by local government, is paid for by the state. So every one of us use government. Nobody in Alaska can say they don't use government. They had to come from somewhere to get here, and that was a road or an airplane or a ferry or something. So why shouldn't we understand that those type of services need to be paid for?
And it's built on a perception that government is too big. That's really what it is. It's a perception. And when you look at where the dollars are spent in our state government, education, health and social services, and then, when you look at the corrections budget, Department of Corrections budget is that way because we choose to put people in jail for longer periods of time, sometimes beyond what makes any sense. And then we don't want to pay for it. So there's all kinds of, I guess, choices that get made that drive budgets. And, you know, if you look at those, our priorities, I think, are pretty well right. Education, health and social services, the university, transportation, and public safety. Those are, you know, corrections and the trooper budget. Those are all important areas of our state budget, and that's where we spend most of the money. So it's a matter of which of those unpopular or unfavorable choices you want to make.
Are there any secrets to being in the legislature that you'd like to reveal?
Gail, somebody running for office really should take a speed reading class before they ever run for office and get elected. That is amazing criteria if you have the ability to speed read, because you get so much stuff presented to you. So
a remedial course in economics.
And you should be able to get along with only about 4 hours of sleep a night, and you should be able to live with a completely disrupted personal health schedule. Everything of that goes out the window when you become a legislator.
I mean, I think legislators work hard, right?
They do.
Yes. Most of them do. Probably there's some exceptions. But I think that they work hard and try to do what they think is right for the state. Yeah. What's the best piece of advice you could give them? Let's ask that.
My uncle Jim Dugan was the delegate to the Constitutional Convention, and he used to come visit me when I was in the legislature. So I'm going to give the same advice to the legislature now that he gave me. He said, you know, Mike, back then we did the best job we could with the information that we had. Now it's your turn. Do the best job you can.
I would encourage legislators not to take a firm position on something too early, before you have actually got a good understanding of the pros and cons and the alternatives. I think as a freshman legislator, somebody comes up to you, asks you, will you vote for this bill? You say yes too soon, and then you hear the rest of the story about why you shouldn't have said yes, but you've given your vote and saying something like, yes, you can have my vote really means something, or at least it used to. I don't know if it still does. But I think the word of caution here is that often, whether it's from a fellow legislator, from a constituent, from a lobbyist, you lock in too soon. And I think in this fiscal discussion we're having, that's a problem. If you say no new taxes under any circumstances, you know, you can get yourself in a terrible box once you know the rest of the story. So I think that's the word of advice I would give, is to be a good listener, to stay open, and to understand that pretty much every simple sounding solution is probably wrong, and that you really need to hear the rest of the story before you make up your mind.
Rick, you must have something to say.
I think one of the, democracy is the best system we could have, but its greatest shortcoming is that it overrepresents the present and underrepresents the future. And any time you can, look as far forward as you can, and try to represent those who are unrepresented and aren't here yet, but will have to deal with the decisions you make, whether it's economic, whether it's resources. There's kind of a category that covers an awful lot of things, and it's the needs of the present versus the much higher priorities of the future that are unrepresented.
And boy, has that played out in our fiscal matter, because Since oil started flowing in 1977, those of us who have been lucky enough to live here, boy, have we had a free ride and a great ride. Yeah. You know, when you think about the amount of money that has been spent on this generation of Alaskans, and the fact that we didn't have to pay any taxes, and we got our dividends, and. So intergenerational equity, you know, I think about that a lot. I think all of us who have kids think about, gee, did this last 30 or 40 year period take too much of the value of Prudhoe Bay instead of rolling more of it forward? Again, I just say thank goodness we adopted the permanent fund, or otherwise we'd have even more guilt on our hands.
Yeah. We've saved one quarter of the greatest oil field in North American history, but in the same time, in one political generation, we spent $100 billion of unearned income. A lot of money.
So I think we have to do something other than hope that oil is going to rise in price again.
No, we can't.
Right? We have to do something other than that.
Right. Yeah. That would be the worst thing that the legislature could do, I think, is if they would say, well, we're going to bet on the come that, you know, the price of oil is going to go up. We don't have to do anything. We'll just wait for the price of oil to come up. I think that would be the very worst thing that they could do this year.
You pointed out that legislators work hard, and they do. And under our system of government, a republic, we have a representative democracy. So we elect people to spend time digesting the issues and the information and making the tough decisions. That's what the legislature is. And so I think that the legislature needs to trust itself to do the right thing, and then recognize that these debates are going to go on beyond this year, but do the best job that they can this year. They've got to trust themselves and trust that the public will recognize that the tough decisions they made, if they made them for the right reasons, I think they'll respect that. The public will respect that.
We've only got a few minutes left here in the show. Do you have any final thoughts to wrap up before we leave you? Gail?
Well, I'd like to say to the legislature, my youngest grandson is a fifth generation Alaskan. And I have two wonderful grandsons that live in Anchorage. And I certainly hope that the action that we took as legislators, the action that legislators take today, and the governors take today, and the governors that take the next, and the legislators the next, will do everything in their power to make sure our kids, and especially those grandsons of mine, have a chance to stay here in Alaska and live a good life like we have had.
I think I said.
Okay. Mike Navarre.
You know, I just encourage them to think about the future, and I certainly will support the decisions that they make. I served in the legislature. I know how difficult the job is, and I thank them for the job and the service they're doing for Alaskans.
Okay. And Fran Ulmer.
We have a lot of tools left in our toolbox to fix our problem, to rise to the occasion to actually avoid a disaster, and I hope that the legislators will find the courage to act and understand that if they do so, they will be able to live with themselves and be able to feel as though they have exercised the leadership that we expect of them.
Okay, thank you very much. That's all the time we have. We've been speaking with Fran Ulmer, Rick Halford, Gail Phillips, and Mike Navarre with Dermot Cole and Matt Buxton. I'm Jeremy Shea. Thanks for joining us on Forum at 360.
Funding for Forum at 360 comes from Rainbow Foods of Juneau.